Lifetime Achievement Award on this date, the 25th of July 2021, citation awarded to Professor R. Porkodi for her outstanding contribution to the society in the field of medicine. Awarded MBBS from Kilpok Medical College in 1975, MD General Medicine in 1980, and DM in Rheumatology 1995 from Madras Medical College. She has worked both at Stanley Medical College and Madras Medical College in the Department of Rheumatology and subsequently superannuated in 2010 as Professor and Head of the Department, Institute of Rheumatology at MMC. Now she is a consultant at Kamakshi Memorial at Dr. Kamakshi Memorial Hospital in Chennai. She is the first qualified lady rheumatologist in India. She was awarded the Indo Gold Medal in Pharmacology. She has 77 publications and several chapters in various rheumatology books. Her main area of interest is managing inflammatory arthritis. Her motto is to create awareness of rheumatology among medical students and to the public. She is a life member of the Indian Medical Association, Chennai Kodambakkam branch, Indian Rheumatology Association, APLAR, and member of Association of Physicians of India, Chennai chapter. We, president and members of the Indian Medical Association, Chennai Kodambakkam branch, feel proud to honor a doyen in the medical field. Madam Professor Porkodi, would you like to say a few words, please? I'll have to unmute yourself, Professor Porkodi.
Good evening. Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
We can't see you. Yes, I can see you. See. I'll spotlight you. Go ahead.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
Good evening. I'm really honored to receive this Lifetime Achievement Award from IMA Kodambakkam. And my heartfelt thanks to IMA Kodambakkam. I had completed my MD General Medicine in 1980 and joined the Tamil Nadu Medical Services. Initially, for the first 2 years, I was posted in the non-clinical side as there was no vacancies in the medicine side. I joined as tutor in physiology KMC, then tutor in pharmacology Stanley, and tutor in pharmacology Madras Medical College. It was here my career changed. Postgraduate service PG in MD pharmacology, who had completed his MD, had to be accommodated in the department. So I had to be shifted out. At the same time, rheumatology department of MMC was looking for an assistant. Dr. Lalita Kameshwaran, who was the professor of professor of pharmacology, passed this message to Professor A.N. Chandrasekhar that I can be accommodated in that department. And so Professor A.N.C. got me transferred as tutor in rheumatology, Madras Medical College in 1982. That's how I happened to enter rheumatology. I did not ask for it. It was a God-sent position for me. I did not know anything of rheumatology when I entered the department because we were not taught rheumatology in undergraduate or postgraduate in those days. The Department of Rheumatology at Madras Medical College was unique, being the only department of rheumatology in India, the first department to be headed by a professor of rheumatology and exclusively for rheumatology. Elsewhere, it was only the medicine unit that was looking after rheumatology. And DM in rheumatology was started for the first time in India in Madras Medical College in 1991, and I joined in 92. Arthroscopic services were also available for the first time in the rheumatology department of Madras Medical College in a government setup. Not even the ortho departments had arthroscopy. We did arthroscopy of knee joint for synovial biopsy and joint cavity lavage to relieve the pain and inflammation. Rheumatologists are interested now in musculoskeletal ultrasound because that is easier to identify joint pathology without going for MRI. And an ultrasound machine is also available in rheumatology department of MMC. Treatment modalities have changed over the decades. In the 1980s, when we started treating rheumatoid, we had only aspirin or ibuprofen as pain relieving drugs. And injection ACTH used to be given for those with severe pain and inflammation as inpatients for about 10 to 15 days. We did not give oral steroids at that time. And disease modifying drugs were chloroquine, D-penicillamine, and gold preparations like myocrosin injection or oralofen. In the 90s came methotrexate and hydroxychloroquine, which was considered more safe to chloroquine as far as the retina is concerned. Then sulfasalazine and leflunomide were other drugs that we are using. In the 20s came the era of biologics, anti-TNF therapy, anti-B-cell therapy, rituximab, and we have the IL-6 receptor antagonist, tocilizumab. And of late, we have the targeted small molecules, the JAK kinase inhibitors, the fasitinib and baricitinib in the management. Now, coming to the various rheumatological problems that we encounter, all patients presenting with symmetrical peripheral arthritis are not rheumatoid. Patients with psoriasis, diabetes, hypothyroid can all present with symmetrical peripheral polyarthritis. Arthritis may be the initial presentation of an underlying connective tissue disease like systemic lupus, systemic sclerosis, mixed connective tissue disease, polymyositis, vasculitis. In all these conditions, rheumatoid factor can also be positive and may be misleading. So every patient has to be followed up for development of any signs of other connective tissue diseases. Even extrapulmonary tuberculosis can present with polyarthritis, known as Poncet disease. It's a reactive arthritis to tuberculosis infection elsewhere in the body. Hansen's disease can present like rheumatoid. Only features like nerve thickening, peripheral nerve thickening, anesthetic patch, or wasting of muscles of the hand can point to the diagnosis. Even infective endocarditis can present with polyarthritis, and the rheumatoid factor can be positive in infective endocarditis. Carcinomatous polyarthritis is a manifestation of an internal malignancy, a neoplastic syndrome. So all polyarthritis need not be rheumatoid. They have to be followed up and investigated. Young males presenting with inflammatory back pain have to be evaluated for spondyloarthritis. Inflammatory back pain is insidious in onset, associated with morning stiffness, and relieved with exercise, and there is no radiation of pain beyond the thighs. On the other hand, a mechanical back pain due to any disc problem is acute in onset, aggravated by exercise, and relieved with rest, and there is radiation of pain down the limbs, and there may be neurological signs. MRI of the pelvis for sacroiliitis and HLA-B27, a genetic marker, will help in establishing the diagnosis. Gout is another common problem which is seen due to hyperuricemia. They present with an acute attack of pain and swelling of the great toe, the first metatarsal phalangeal joint, ankle or knee. Hypouricemic drugs like Xyloric or febuxostat should not be started during an acute attack of gout. Anti-inflammatory drugs like colchicine or other NSAIDs have to be given to reduce the pain and inflammation, and only then should the hypouricemic drugs, Xyloric or febuxostat, should be started. Children can also present with various rheumatological problems that we see in the elderly. Children below 16 years of age are present with arthritis, like called as juvenile idiopathic arthritis, juvenile onset ankylosing spondylitis, juvenile dermatomyositis, childhood onset lupus, and childhood vasculitis like Hinox-Schönlein purpura or Kawasaki. Even in children, children with leukemias, acute leukemias, can present with polyarthritis if they do not respond to NSAIDs and they have severe anemia, once and external tenderness or bone marrow tenderness, suspicion of an underlying hematological malignancy should be considered. Aplas syndrome is another common feature that we see. That is antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, which may be primary or it may be secondary to some underlying connective tissue disease like lupus. Here, patients present with recurrent arterial thrombosis, recurrent venous thrombosis, and recurrent feature loss. It's the gynecologist who referred cases to us for recurrent feature loss for Aplas syndrome. And these patients have to be treated with anticoagulants. Even in COVID, there is immune dysregulation and production of autoantibodies and immunoinflammatory cytokines. And this is responsible for the cytokine storm. This picture is similar to the macrophage activation syndrome we see in our rheumatological problems. In children, multisystem inflammatory syndrome and Kawasaki disease are seen in children with COVID. So that because of the same immunoinflammation that occurs in rheumatological diseases are seen in COVID, they are being treated with drugs, these tocilizumab, tofacitinib, or baricitinib. Though rheumatological diseases are chronic, emergencies can occur even in rheumatology. Even in a rheumatoid patient can present with a flare of their arthritis. There can be aseptic arthritis of the joint. They can have atlantoaxial subluxation, scleromalacia perforans in the eye, and rheumatoid vasculitis can present as digital gangrene. When rupture of a Baker's cyst can present as an acute emergency in rheumatoid. In ankylosing spondylitis, they can present with neurological symptoms like cauda equina syndrome, or they can have a transverse myelitis due to discitis. Anderson lesions in the spine can present as paraplegia. Scleroderma can present with scleroderma renal crisis, where there's an accelerated hypertension and renal failure. In lupus, we can have any emergencies from seizures, strokes, CNS vasculitis. They can have endocarditis or myocarditis, acute alveolar hemorrhage, acute pancreatitis, abdominal vasculitis, digital gangrene. They can present with Guillain-Barré syndrome or transverse myelitis. Any system can present as an emergency in a patient with lupus. And more important in all these patients is the risk of infection because they are on steroids and immunosuppressants. So it is sometimes difficult to differentiate whether it is due to sepsis or due to disease flare. So, and we have other diseases like the degenerative joint diseases like osteoarthritis and osteoporosis, and soft tissue rheumatism, and fibromyalgia rheumatica, chronic pain syndrome. These are some of the other rheumatological manifestations that we come across. So this is in brief the various rheumatological problems that we come across. I have really reached 40 years of service in rheumatology, and I have no regrets for having taken up rheumatology. I'm happy with this field, and I'm able to serve people who come with severe pain and relieve them of their pain and suffering. Thanks for giving this opportunity. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Madam, that was a wonderful journey. That was a really wonderful journey and really heartening to hear. And we really didn't know that you had the first arthroscopy in the whole of GH. We really did not know that you were the first department in the whole of India.
Thank you, sir.
It was so nice to hear it from you. Thank you so much.
It all goes to Professor A.N. Chandrasekaran. I owe to him. It was he who established the department. He who was responsible for bringing in DM rheumatology. And his work is being carried on by his successors.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.